in God's Word. That's what we're doing here, right? So I would invite you to grab a copy of God's Word, the Bible. If you have one, awesome. If you don't, there's plenty of them. There's these blue ones here. They're in the seat back in front of you. They're on the tables. If you're in the front row, there might be some underneath you here. But please get a copy of God's Word in your hand. And if you're new here and you're just checking out the church, we study God's Word. And so we just sang to Jesus, right? That was awesome, right? But now we get to listen to Jesus. And we do that by studying His Word carefully. And so if you're not used to getting a Bible out in church, now's the time to change that trend and pick up a Bible and put your eyes on it, please. So we will be in Luke chapter 7. So if you want to start turning there, you can. But as you do, I'd like to talk to you about something. First and foremost, before we jump into the Word, I want to do this. Many of you know Mike and Cindy Gregoire, and Cindy went in for thyroid surgery just the other day, and she is home and she's healing, but I got a text just before we came out here from Mike saying, "Pastor Moses, please have the church pray for Cindy. She's having a very difficult time this evening with her healing process." So I don't know the details, but would you guys do that with me for just before we jump into the Bible? Can we just honor his desire to reach out to God on behalf of his wife, and let's join him in that, right? So Lord, we just want to stand right now in agreement with Mike in asking that you would bring healing and peace and comfort. You're the comforter. That's who you are, Lord. And so we pray that you would bring supernatural comfort, not just to Cindy and healing to her body, but to Mike. Mike loves his wife. She is a treasure to him. And so he freaks out when she's not feeling well, and because he's a great husband, that's why. And so we just want to join him in lifting her up to you and asking that you would bring healing to her body. Lord, let her know that even though she couldn't come, and I know it just drives them crazy not to be here, Lord, that you are there with them and that you love them dearly, dearly, Lord. And if you would let them somehow know in your amazing God abilities that we don't have, to let them know we're praying for them right now, that they would know that they're loved not just by you, but by us as well. That would be incredible. So we thank you for this, Lord. Thank you for letting them be a part of our family as well. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I posted something on Facebook. I guess it was yesterday. Maybe it was yesterday, the day before. I'm not quite sure. And I asked, I said, what is the craziest prediction or claim you've ever heard anybody make? So I got a bunch of different things, and of course, most of it was about Hillary and Trump, because we're still riding that stupid wave, but hopefully that's put to sleep here soon. But I'm not going to share those. I want to share a couple of them with you. One, I don't have a picture for it, but here's the first one. Remember back in 1999, do you remember Y2K? Right? Everyone laughed, right? They said that it's going to be the end of the world, right? The electricity is going to stop. The internet's going to stop. Crops are going to stop growing. People are going to stop talking. Everyone's going to die. And then look. We're here. Right? Woohoo! We're here, right? So that was kind of stupid, right? So that was one of them. Here's the other one. I have a buddy. He used to come to this church before they moved away. And he's a good dude, man. But I won't say his name because most of the time he's online. He's cussing his brains out. But he used to come to this church, and maybe he needs to come back. But he said that the stupidest claim he ever heard anyone say is that he had a buddy who said he could take Brock Lesnar in a fight. Anyone ever? Yeah, there's Brock Lesnar, right? He's a WWE superstar. He was a cage fighter. How many people do you think could take that dude, right? Probably not going to happen. Probably not. Who? Yeah, Mike. Sure. Right. Yeah. 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 So that was one. How about this next guy? I'm going to put a picture up. Anyone have any idea who that is? Not Don King. Yeah. That's pretty. Yeah. We know who that is, right? No one can mistake that. That guy right there, relative obscurity, and for good reason. That is Hurricane Pete McNeely. Hurricane Pete McNeely was a heavyweight boxer in the 90s, And he challenged Mike Tyson. Y'all know who Mike Tyson is, right? He could probably take Brock Lesnar, Mike Tyson, right? He was beast, right? So this guy, he's from Medford, Mass, right? So I try to get rid of my accent, but he hasn't. And he got up in 1995 and he challenged Mike Tyson to a fight. And this is what he said, his famous line. He said that I'm going to wrap Mike Tyson in a cocoon of horror. That's what he said. I'm going to wrap him up in a cocoon of horror, right? But look at the next picture. It didn't happen that way. That happened twice in the first round. And he was whooped and beaten. Didn't even get to the second round. Stupid, stupid claim, right? I don't know if you've ever had any stupid claims in your life. You didn't post them, but I got a really, really crazy, outrageous claim. Over 2,000 years ago, a virgin who most people thought was a whore got pregnant. And she married this nobody who was a carpenter from this podunk town. Think, no offense, Paisley. Okay? That's where Joseph was from. And they got married, and they had a baby in a barn, right? In a barn. Nobody wanted them, nowhere to go, no fame, no fortune, and this little baby is born, and he falls off the map for like 30 years, and then all of a sudden he strolls onto the scene, and he looks at 12 guys that were equally nobody, and he looks at them and he says, I'm going to build my church, and hell will not stop it. That's stupid. That's crazy. Think about it. There's no reason in the world that this guy could make such a crazy claim. Unless it was real, right? Unless it was real. It was outrageous. But with all indications, it's working out pretty well. So he goes to these 12 guys, and he says, I'm going to build my church to 12 dudes that were nobodies. And now it's 2 billion strong, and that's just who's alive right now, right? It doesn't count for the people that were alive 100 years ago and 100 years before that and 100 years before that, right? It went from 12 to billions of people. And this little ministry that was only like 3 years in this little area of the world that was like within 100 square miles of nothingness now spans the globe. And there's Christians in every country on the planet. And there's Bible translators hitting every nook and cranny of the world and missionaries going out and sending forth to the gospel to the ends of the earth. And Christianity is growing and growing and growing and spanning the globe now. It's working. It's working really well. And the way that Jesus has done this, and listen, if you're a Christian, praise God, this is how he did it with you. It's quite simple. This is how he got you on the team. He simply revealed himself to you. That's it. That's it. Every one of our faith stories is unique. Like no one came to Christ the exact same way. Every story is unique. Pause there for a second. Rejoice in your story and share your story. A lot of people don't necessarily want to or care to hear your Bible verses. They want to hear what your Bible has done in you. Okay, so share your story. But no matter what your story is, there's one thing that's the same in every single story, and that is God showed up in it somehow, some way. And you said, yep, I need him. I need that. That's it. That's what happened, okay? And you know what? That's not something new that's just in the New Testament either. Did you know that? It's really not. As a matter of fact, God's word in Romans chapter 1, verse 20 states that since the beginning of time, he's been doing that. He showed up for every single person and made himself known. So that's not the first time that this has happened when the New Testament started. It's been happening all throughout history. And the Bible, which, you know, we call the blueprint for life and the roadmap for living and God's love letter to you, right? And it is all those things, right? But really, at the end of the day, if you kind of just melt down the meta-narrative of the Bible, it's basically this. This is who I am, and this is how you ought to live in light of me. That's it. Would you agree? If you've read the Bible, really, that's all. It's 66 books and thousands of different stories, but at the end of the day, it's God saying, this is who I am. This is who you should. This is how you should respond in light of who I am, period. But sadly, ever since the beginning, people have been taking genuine and good, and I'm going to say this, religion, and when I say religion, I just want to say it's basically how we react and respond to God. Okay? There's some that's good, right? And then there's some that's bad. And so don't just group it all in with this one word and saying all religion's bad, because it's not true. The Bible even says that there's some form of good religion. I believe it's in the book of James. But the way that we interact and respond with God is a religion, but unfortunately, oftentimes, man shows up and kind of makes up their own thing, you see. And that's, look at your neighbor and say, that's a bad idea. That's a bad, bad idea. Now listen, generally speaking, when that happens, it takes on two forms, okay? It takes on two forms. So if you have a notebook, and I hope that you do, I hope that you have a pen and a notebook, awesome, right? Jot these two things down. Here's the first one. First group, and hopefully you're not in either one of them, but don't start thinking about the ones who are. Just let's fight our own fight, okay? There's two things that that happen often. Too much and too little. Too much religion, too little religion. Let's talk a little bit about the first one. It's too much. Okay. I'm not creative enough to make anything up. So where am I going to find too much? Guess. What do we do here? Right, the Bible. In the Bible, there is a very sad story of those who have too much. And I'm sad to say that I'm part of that. I'm Jewish, right? So the Jewish people, whether you know it or not, they have over 600 rules that they've created to kind of, if you will, I can't even get, I got to step away from the Bible to say this, okay? To enhance God's word. I just didn't want to get struck, okay? To enhance God's word, okay? It's basically here's God's word, right? Standard. Here's our word. And you got to keep our word, because if you don't honor our word, you broke God's word. That's insane, right? God's word's sufficient. God's word is enough, right? So, but if you break our rules and you don't honor them, you broke God's rules. But what we also find in Scripture is that those people that do this often err in another way, and that is they take God's word and then they also heap on all the other rules, and instead of using it to bring honor to God, they use it to bring honor and attention to themselves. And you see it in the New Testament over and over and over again. These people, they're called the Pharisees. These were Jewish guys that kept these rules. And you see it all the time. They wanted to dress real nice, look at my holy garments, and they would march through town, and they loved it when people threw a title at them and said, oh, Rabbi, and listen how we pray, and watch how I do this, and I get to sit at the head of the table, right? Listen, no, that's actually awful, right? And Jesus came for many reasons, but one of the main reasons that Jesus came was to dismantle this system, okay? Dismantle it completely. As a matter of fact, he would blow it up. The Apostle Paul was one of the greatest men who ever lived, and he was one of these guys. And if you would do me a favor and keep your finger in Luke chapter 7 and go to Philippians chapter 3, I'd like to share with you what Paul the Apostle, this religious dude, and you might know his story, I don't know if you do or not, but he was a Jewish guy who kept all the rules. We're going to read that in a second. And then he had this conversion. He actually met with Jesus, because guess what? Jesus, in an aggressive way, but just like I told you before, he revealed himself to you. He revealed himself to Paul, to Saul, became Paul, totally changed his life, okay? Radically changed his life. So what we see here is Paul, now under the inspiration of God's Spirit, he's penning this thing to the people in Philippi, in Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 5. I want to just read this to you. It's the second half of the verse. He talks about this whole law thing, okay? Jesus came to dismember this thing, right? Okay. Paul says, I was a member of the Pharisees, who demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. Can I preach for just a second? Is that okay? Okay. It says that they demanded the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. You know what's awesome about Christianity? Yeah. None of us can demand anything of you. I can't demand anything of you. You know? I have no rules. I have no standards that you have to do. Right? God has some commands, right? Amen. And they're not suggestions, they're commands. And he insists upon you doing them, right? But we, the church, the pastors and the elders and the deacons and the bishops and all these people in the church leadership, like, we can't demand anything of you, right? That's the beautiful thing about Christianity, is that God is the only one that has any commands. We're just faithful servants doing our duty up here. That's it. Okay, so we got to get off that whole thing where certain religions and leaders can demand anything of anybody. That's not, like, it's not the church of me. It's the church of Jesus. Okay, so we need to know that. All right, let's get back on track. So he says that they demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. So he's talking about this group that wants to keep these 600 plus laws. They demand the strictest obedience. He goes on, he says, I was so zealous about this that I harshly persecuted the church. Can I preach again? Okay. So he's like, I keep this so serious that I'm gonna penalize and punish you if you don't. I'm this and you're not, and I'm coming after you. And let me tell you something. It's swapped. It's switched. Too often, instead of the Jews persecuting the church, the church is persecuting the world. We need to stop, right? We need to stop. It's come full circle, man. We look and we are on Facebook and you don't keep my rule and you're a terrible person and that's just what Paul did, right? And it's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. Okay, so let's go on. He says, I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church as for righteousness. So in other words, he's like, I'm a part of this group. And they demand the strictest obedience to the law. And how was I doing, he says? Well, I obeyed it without fault. So he was perfect. He was a member of the group. He punished those that were not keeping the rule. And he was perfect at it. You ever have someone like pick on you? And you're like, well, what right do you have? You know, he without sin cast the first stone, right? You ever heard people say that, right? He was that. He was keeping it perfectly. He had kind of a right to kind of get on to people. But, you got to read on. Verse 7. I once thought these things, what things? The law, strict obedience to it, persecuting those who are not following it. There's three things there, right? He said, I once thought that these three things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Okay, so you might be thinking, well, Moses, this is not apropos to me. I'm not that guy. I'm not that girl. I'm not a member of the Pharisees. I'm not some strict law person that says, I keep the law perfectly. You need to keep it too. Just like me or else. Maybe that's not you. And if it's not you, praise God that it's not you. But I believe that God is sovereign. And I believe that God knows that that's not you. And I believe God still has a word directly into your heart. He's going to come tenaciously after your heart right now. Even if you're not that Pharisee, are you ready to be invaded? Okay, here we go. You ready? He said, I consider all those things, the law and keeping it perfectly and persecuting those who don't. Those are worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, now listen how he ups the ante big time. He leaves all that stuff in the past. He says, yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded what? Everything else, all things, counting it all as garbage so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. Can I preach again? Okay, so I'm glad you said it because that's what I do. That would be rotten if you said no. Okay, so notice here for a second. He says, everything else is worthless compared. So there's a lot of things that you do in your life, right? Maybe you're not the law keeper. I shouldn't say that to you. I hope you are. That was good. So maybe you're not the Jewish law keeper, flawlessly, and picking on everybody who doesn't. Maybe that's not you. But maybe there are some things in your life that you hold sacred, that you enjoy, that are good things. Maybe a lot of times I don't see you here because this is going to sting. Maybe you're not here because you're a soccer game, football game, basketball game, baseball game, picking up your mom at the airport, having dinner with your friends, doing whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it is. Are those bad things? Would I ever tell you that they're bad things? I don't think God's word says that they're bad things at all. As a matter of fact, I think it says something different. I think it says everything else is worthless when compared to. See, anything that's, and then he goes on, he says, anything that's compared to the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. So what's he trying to tell you? That these things that are good, that you have been given by him for your joy, if they get in the way of you knowing Christ intimately, they need to go. That was an awesome spot for an amen. Amen. And I fear, this is the fear, I fear that much of the church, not just this church, but most churches would not amen that spot. And that's the problem. He said he discarded these things because they're garbage. Compared. Did he say don't go to soccer games with your kids? Never. Should you go to soccer games with your kids? Yes. Should you take them to SeaWorld? Yes. But if it gets in the way, if it stands in confrontation with your relationship with the Lord Jesus, it's got to go. And I can't explain to you how good it will be if you do it. You have to do it yourself to find out. I wish I could help you, but I just can't. I can tell you in my own life when I've discarded things to pursue my relationship with the Lord, that it's been good for me. But I can't tell you, I can't put it in words. I don't have the capacity in my brain and my vocabulary to explain to you what you're going to experience if you do it. I'm just telling you, you should. That's what it's teaching us here. Anything that gets in the way of this relationship with the Lord, count it as garbage. It's nothing compared to knowing Christ and becoming one with him. I no longer count my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself depends on faith. So a lot of people add too much to God's word. It's sufficient. In the book of Acts, the early church got together, and here are these people trying to heap all these rules back onto people. And Jesus even told these Pharisees, you heap all these rules on people, then you won't even help them. You're never getting into heaven, and they won't either. You're the blind leading the blind. Stop it. And so the early church leaders decided, let's make it easy for those that are coming to the Lord, right? How many of us, including myself, I don't need anyone in this room now to say this, how many of us are keeping all this? You need more? Who needs more, right? Come on, we can't even keep 10, right? Who needs 600 more? Let's just work on like the first four. What about the first one, making God, God, and no other gods before him? Let's just work on that. You work on that one, you don't need the rest of them, right? They're all, it's all good. So let's just work on that. Let's keep it easy for those coming to the Lord. So too often people make too much religion, and down with that, okay? Here's the second one, you can jot this down too. Too little. Are you a Christian? I believe in God and all that, those people. I believe in God and we got a thing and I pray with in the shower and on my car ride and in my deer stand and stuff and you don't need to go to church to be a Christian. Okay. I'm going to tell you right now, we need to put that, can I say this? Crap to bed. Okay? That's all it is. That's pathetic. Okay? I'm all about people being genuine, authentic followers of Christ. That's what our church needs to be. Like following Christ, right? Not making up our own stuff to convenience ourselves, but following Jesus. I believe in God. James 2:19, even the demons believe, right? And they tremble, right? They believe a ton. I'm not saying that you're a demon, okay? I'm not saying that you're a demon. I've met some folks that go to church that they might not be demons, but they probably have lunch with them a lot or something. But they're not demons, right? But so you might say, well, I'm not a demon. Okay, well, how about this? How about Romans chapter 1? And I think it's the same with people that it is with demons. The demons believe and they tremble. They know that God is real. They believe in him. But they do nothing to willfully obey and honor him, right? That's not what they do. They're awful at very best. They have to submit to the authority of the Creator. So when he says, be gone out of that body, they have to go. But they don't want to. He's not their Lord, right? He's not their Lord. But Romans 1 says that God has been revealing himself to people since the beginning. But yet, they know God, people, everyone has said, but they won't worship him as God. And they won't give him thanks. And they come up with foolish ideas about who God is and what he's like, right? It's the same as the demons, right? It's the same. Everyone knows that there's a God, but they won't treat him as such. Believe in God, and I talk to him, my deer stand. And you don't have to go to church to be a Christian. So let's shed light on that lie from the pit of hell. Okay? What does it mean to be a Christian? Can I just offer this to you? Let's involve the congregation with the sermon. You ready? Christ followers, I'll start the sentence, you finish it. You ready? Talking about Jesus now. We do as what? We do as, I'll give you the first one, as he does. Okay, so now you got it. We say what? We go where he, and we think as he. Awesome. Christ followers follow Christ, right? And Jesus Christ, did you know that he wrote a book? Did you know that? Right? So this Spirit of Christ has inspired men to write some specific things to you so that you would know how to follow him. And in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, he said, "Don't neglect meeting together." Is it any more clear than that? Okay? Do me a favor. Look at your neighbor and say, "Stop blowing off church." That was pretty easy, would you think? Do you think that was pretty easy? Let's do something that's a lot more difficult, but I believe that you can do it. Let's look back at that same person, and don't accuse them, because that's what you just did. You just accused them of not going to church. Look at your neighbor, following God's word, look at that same person and say, I will no longer blow off church. God takes no pleasure in a man or a woman who takes a vow and does not keep it. Too bad. Yeah. Listen, there's a good reason to blow off church. If you're dead, don't come. Right? Christ followers follow Christ, right? Is that what his word said? There's people all over the world that aren't in church worshiping God, and they say, well, my temple is in the woods, and it's in the deer stand, it's on the fishing, in the lake, and on the way to work. And listen, those are all great places, and God will meet you there. I get it. But this stuff that we just did right here, when Toy, who she can't even breathe, she's got a baby, and she's belting out those songs, and we're all together worshiping the Lord, like you can't get this in the tree stand. You can get the tree stand in the tree stand, but you can't get this in the tree stand. You get that? So you come here and you worship God together, collectively, and God inhabits the praises of his people. So when you're here worshiping, there's some energy and some power here. And you can't get this anywhere else. So you come, right? Christ's followers follow Christ, right? You all admitted this. Now, before the verse goes up on the screen, I want you to do me a favor. Does everyone in here agree that Christ followers follow Christ? Yes. You do, right? Okay. Now, do me a favor. With that being said, look at Luke 21, verse 37, with your own eyes. Put your eyes on God's word. That's an awesome sound right there. Beautiful. I'm not going to speed past this one. Church has taken a bum rap. Like, people don't go to church anymore. That they seem to think that you could be a Christian, but you don't have to gather for worship, and you don't necessarily have to bring yourself, which inside of you there's a spiritual gift that you have that you're supposed to share to build up the rest of the body of Christ. You know, I get a phone call from someone recently. We feel like this is where God wants us to be, but we have gifting. We want to share it. We want to bless the church. How can we do that? Like, that's the spirit you got to have, right? So listen, but unfortunately, people are sitting at the soccer field right now. Right now. If anything gets in the way of your intimacy with the Lord, it's garbage. It needs to be discarded. Do you see? I know this is harsh, but this is what the Bible says, not me. I'd love to blow it off sometimes and jump on my motorcycle, throw my hot wife in the back and say, see you guys, but that's not what I'm created to do. I've been created to do this, and this is what I must do. You understand? So what does it say in Luke 21, 37? You can bring the verse back. You can bring it up now. You all read it, right? What does it say there? Every day, Jesus went to the temple to teach. Right? So listen, and again, this is a stinger, and this is not to condemn or sting anyone. I just want a quality of discipleship. I'm not telling you got to go to church every single day. What I'm telling you is that Jesus was busy. Have you read the Bible, right? He was extremely busy. He was going around, traveling around. He didn't have a car. He walked from town to town, and he was healing people by the sometimes thousands, feeding people by the thousands, teaching and praying and healing and casting out demons. He was busy, but still in the busyness, he somehow found time in 24 hours that we have also to go to the temple Every day he went to church. And he didn't just go and sit in the pew. As tired as he was, he knew his purpose, and that's your purpose too. And he didn't just go to church. He went to church and he taught there every single day. Now, I'm not telling you have to go to church every single day. But what I am saying is that Jesus Christ came to save you. He's the King. He's the Lord. He's the Savior. He's God, right? He's the Creator. But he's also our great example. And if Christ followers follow Christ, if Jesus Christ went to church every single day, don't you think you could come once? Amen. Amen. Right? I'm not trying to be harsh. I'm encouraging you because I'm telling you, your greatest life is if you're obedient to God's word. And if you will plug yourself into the church and make a commitment, we could rock this city if everyone came and worshiped and served in an amazing way. And that's what the world needs. And there's churches all over the country and all over the world where people are getting after that thing and it's rocking their city. And I believe that for this church. I believe it with all my heart. And so God goes to church every single day and he taught every single day. And so I'm just saying, maybe you don't need to go every day, but is it fair to say that you don't have to go to church to be a Christian when the one who is the author and finisher of our faith, the one whose this faith is named after, the one who inspired the word that all the word points to, the creator of heaven and earth, the perfecter of our faith, he went to church every day. So do you think that it's reasonable that you should go to church on the weekend? I think it's kind of reasonable. I don't think it's outrageous. So I think we should just put that foolish lie to bed. And you can remember that verse. When someone says, you don't have to go to church to be a Christian, it's just because they don't care enough to go. But you can just say, hey, well, I get that, but Jesus went to church every day. And I follow Jesus. I'm a Christ follower, and I follow Christ. So oftentimes people have too much religion, some have too little, and Jesus arrives on the scene to rescue us by revealing God to people, to us, more clearly than has ever been done before. Not to declare and display more rules and regulations, not to display more traditions or customs. No, the fullness of deity was pleased to dwell in Christ. And Christ said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right? This is what God is doing in the flesh as Jesus Christ. He is revealing himself to the world, not by rules and regulations, but by the person of Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 1 says that God speaks through the Son, not the Son, the Son, S-O-N, Jesus Christ, and that the Son, Jesus Christ, radiates God's glory, and he radiates the very character of God. There's two big things in our sky. There's the sun, and then there's the moon. So the moon, and the moon is a great mystery to me. I don't even understand how that all works. Sometimes it's big, the next day it's small, you go out an hour later, it's gone. Like, what happened? It's a freaky thing. But the moon is a dead rock. Did you know this? It's just a floating mirror orbiting through space. And it has no life of its own. It reflects, right? It reflects the sun. So the sun is different than the moon, see? The moon reflects the sun, see? I'm talking about moon, so it could have been something else, just, you know, okay? So that was a good one. But the sun is different. The sun has its own light and its own heat and its own power, right? And that's what the Bible's saying about Jesus, that he is not reflecting who God the Father is, right? No, all that God is was in Jesus Christ, and what's coming out of Jesus is not a reflection of God. It is God coming out of him. Because that's who he is, right? He's the Son. Perfect play on words. That's who Jesus Christ is. And he displays the very glory of God, the very character of God. This is who I am. This is who you are. And this is the proper response. It's not about rules. It's about me. That's what he's saying. And so in light of who God is, there is a proper response of faith, or if you will, a proper religious response to who God is. And I believe that the Roman centurion in Luke chapter 7 displays the proper response to who God is. And so as we learn about who Jesus Christ is, and we learn about the teaching of Jesus Christ so that we could have some truth and fire up our spirit, we're going to see what real, authentic faith looks like in a person you would never, ever think would display it. And it's in Luke chapter 7, and I hope that you'll go there, and I'm going to read this story with you. Are you there? Okay. Luke chapter 7, right at the beginning. Just before he preaches, he's doing this, he's telling people about that good things come from a good heart that's been transformed by the gospel, and bad things come from a bad heart that has not been transformed by the gospel. And so what you see here is a perfectly placed story of what a transformed heart would look like, okay? So that you know, because we don't want to chase the phony. We want truth so we can fire up spirit, right? So here we are in Luke chapter 7, starting in verse 1. When Jesus had finished saying all this, this Sermon on the Mount, all kinds of teaching, bad heart, bad stuff, good heart, good stuff, don't call me Lord if you're not going to do what I say. If you do, you're a house on rock, and the floods come, you're going to stand. If you don't, it's going to collapse. He taught all this. Now you're going to see what a person like that really looks like. So here it is. When Jesus had finished saying all this to the people, he returned to Capernaum. At that time, the highly valued slave, and I'm going to pause there for a second, bad translation. Yes, very high valued, but that's not really the best translation here. It's a person that he dearly, that was dear to him, it says in most translations, that he was dear to him. So it was not just like value as in money, what he could get from this guy, but he actually loved this person. There was a deep admiration for this slave. So there was this, at that time, this highly valued, dear in the heart of the Roman officer slave was sick and near death. When the officer heard about Jesus, he sent some respected Jewish elders to ask him to come and heal his slave. So they earnestly begged Jesus to help the man. "If anyone deserves your help, he does," they said, "for he loves the Jewish people and even built a synagogue for us." So Jesus went with them, but just before they arrived at the house, the officer sent some friends to say, "Lord, don't trouble yourself by coming to my home, for I'm not worthy of such an honor. I am not even worthy to come and meet you. Just say the word from where you are, and my servant will be healed. I know this because I am under the authority of my superior officers, and I have authority over my soldiers. I only need to say, go, and they go, or come, and they come. And if I say to my slaves, do this, they do it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed. Turning to the crowd that was following him, he said, "I tell you, I haven't seen faith like this in all Israel." And when the officer's friends returned to his house, they found the slave completely healed. Awesome story. Awesome story. Let me just say that real faith doesn't always wear its Sunday best. See, in our country, I've never been to another country, so I can't vouch for any other place. But in this country, there is a textbook Christian look. Nice shirt, nice slacks, maybe a suit and a tie. The ladies would wear a dress to church. They'd act a certain way. How's everything going? Oh, we're just blessed. You know, all hell's breaking loose in the home. Oh, we're just blessed. Act a certain way, talk a certain way, wear certain clothing. Yeah, that means nothing, okay? It means nothing. That's why when people come into your church and, you know, they're all tatted up and got gold teeth and everything, and people are like, that's not, I'm not a Christian. Really? What does the tattoo have to do with their heart? Nothing, right? But there's a look. There's a way that seems Christian in our country. So you look at this guy right here. First of all, he's a Gentile. So the people that were first coming to the Lord, these were Jewish guys, right? But the Gentile, he was from Rome, right? He wasn't just a Gentile. He was part of the Roman army that were like trained killers, right? He wasn't just a soldier either. He was the soldier's soldier. He was in charge of killers. He was a cage fighter, this guy, like Brock Lesnar with a sword, right? And he was part of the army and the empire and the nation that was oppressing the Jewish people. So a highly unlikely candidate of faith. A very rough and tough guy. He's the guy that doesn't look Christian. But the Jewish slave, it's important, was dear to him. So what's that mean? It means that ethnicity, open the window, out. He didn't care. Wealth and social status, he was a Roman centurion. He was a man of power and prestige on the winning team, right? And here's a Jewish slave, different religion, different ethnicity, different power and prestige, no money and nothing. And all of that, back burner, loved him. That's awesome. That's awesome, right? That's awesome. That's the way the church needs to be. And so what does this guy do, this Roman centurion? It says that he heard about Jesus. Like, he'd never met the guy, but he heard of this rock star that was healing people like crazy and making, you know, 5,000 meals out of a happy meal. And he's like, man, I got this slave. I really love this guy. He means a lot to me. He's my hope. So we got to get this guy to my house, man. So what does he do? He doesn't know Jesus. He's heard of him. What does he do? He does what anyone would do. He's a Roman guy. He sends some Jews. Jesus is a Jew. He's a rabbi, right? So what do? You grab some of the Jewish guys that you know so they can kind of relate, right? We're Jews. So he sends the religious guys because Jesus is probably a Jew. He's a rabbi. He's probably a religious guy too. So send the religious guys. Makes sense, right? Big mistake. Huge mistake. Jesus never said anything good about religious guys, right? So he sends these religious guys, and what does it say that they did? It said that they earnestly begged Jesus to help the man. I don't know about your God, but let me tell you about my God. I don't have to beg my God. I don't have to beg my God. My God is a giver of good gifts. Right? That's what the Bible says, and I'm living proof. I've seen it. I've experienced it. Many of you, if not most of you, already have too. He's not someone that needs to be begged. Please, God, please, over and over again. It's like the story of Elijah on Mount Carmel with the prophets of Baal, the ones who are praying to this false god. What are they doing? They're running around the fire. Oh, Baal, answer us. Oh, Baal, answer us. Oh, Baal, answer us. And they're begging and begging and incantations and over and over and over again, begging God. And Elijah's like, hey, God, can you do this? Wham! Fire from heaven. Because that fire from heaven was to advance his kingdom. It was in his will. He didn't need Elijah to ask for it. He just wanted Elijah to pray and say, can you do it? So that Elijah knew it was him. That's all. He wants you to acknowledge his lordship. That's what your prayers are for. He doesn't need you to beg him. He's a giver of good gifts. He's your dad. He loves you. All these things that he does, if it's in his will, and it's definitely in his power to do so, if it's for his name's sake, to grow his fame and his church and bring blessing to his people, he wants to do it for you. He just needs you to acknowledge him by praying. And if it's in his will, done. You don't need to beg him, okay? So that's the first thing. You don't need to beg. And then they make another bad choice. You see it there? If anyone deserves your help, he does. For he loves the Jewish people and even built a synagogue for them. He was a Roman soldier who didn't have to be nice to Jewish people, but he was. You're going to sniff religion starting here in these people. He was nice. He was charitable. He deserves your blessing, God. He's entitled to it because of what he has done. That's what it says, right? That's what the Jewish people thought. If you're really, really nice and you're nice to the Jewish people and you're very charitable and you give to help us, then God, he deserves your help. If I do this, God will do that. That's man-made religion. Tozer said, God will answer prayers, not because you are good, but because he is. And it's true. Very, very true. How many people think after reading that story that if begging God and saying, this guy is deserving and worthy of your blessing, if that was the right way to go, who thinks that the story would immediately jump over to verse 9 where it would say, Jesus turns to the crowd and go, hey, this guy here, I'm amazed. Let's do it. And he heals the kid. That's what would have happened, right? If that was the right way to do it, that's what would have happened. Would you agree? Yeah, but it didn't. Because it's verse 6, 7, and 8. What happens? See, Jesus knows that's not going to get God's attention. Something else is going to get God's attention. So Jesus goes along with this thing because something's about to happen. You need to see it. Because we're pursuing authentic faith, real faith, right? So he goes with the people. And as he's going along, what happens? Well, he sends a couple of buddies. He sends some buddies. Not religious guys, just regular dudes, right? They don't know anything about this religion and all these laws and this and that. They're just a couple of dudes, man. They shop at Home Depot. And they go up to Jesus, and they have a much different message than the religious people. What's the message they have? It's all summed up in one word right away. Lord, boom. That's it right there. Lord. That's a whole different message than, oh, he's worthy, so he gets it. No, they go on, they say, Lord. Why does God answer prayers? Because of him, not because of you, right? And they even go on to elaborate. And that's the message of the centurion, not theirs, right? I'm not worthy for you to come over to my house. I'm not even worthy to stand in your presence, but Lord, just one word from you, and he could be healed. You see the difference between the two? One is the religious group that says, I've done this and I've done that, so I deserve it, and I'm entitled to it. But the real message of faith is, Lord, I'm not worthy of anything, but you are good. You are good. I'm not worthy. My past and my power as a soldier or a CEO, or a wealthy man, my position, my person, my purse, my perfection. Paul said it's garbage. It's small. I'm small. And God is big. And that's a great place to be. Like humble, humble, small. God, you owe me nothing. God, I acknowledge your reign, this guy says, over sickness and disease, over space, over geography, over time. Just say one word, Lord, awesome. 1 ounce of your grace that owes me nothing, and he would be healed. How much faith did the slave have? Any? It doesn't say, does it? I want to get rid of that teaching too, about how much faith you need to have to be healed. The slave never met Jesus. He's never seen him and most likely had never even heard of him. He was a slave out in the field working. He didn't have the delivery of the news through the Roman culture that the centurion had. The centurion had heard of Jesus, never met Jesus. So how about the slave? Nothing. Like that. Why? For his name's sake. That's why he did it. That's why he did it. So let me, could I ask the band to come up again, please? See, this authentic expression of faith right here that the centurion displayed through his buddies, this is what grabbed God's attention. It's not what they had done or what they deserved. It says that Jesus was amazed. That's a bad translation as well. If you look up the actual word that was used there in the ancient text, it's admired. This is the kind of faith that makes God happy. He's like, I like that faith. That's the kind of faith I like, right there. That's what I like. Jesus admires this kind of faith. Not one that looks the part. Not one that earns or demands or feels entitled in some way. Now, Jesus, at this point, after the Roman centurion displays this type of faith that says, listen, I am not worthy of anything, but you are good and you are powerful, and one word from you, and I know that this person that you've never seen could be healed. That's submitting, listen, that's submitting to the lordship of Jesus Christ. And that's what the Roman centurion did. And so he turns to the crowd, Jesus, at this moment, in front of all these Jewish people, and he says, I admire that faith right there, of a Gentile Jew oppressor. I have not seen faith like this in all of Israel. Now imagine standing up in front of the church of a whole country and saying, all of you that think you've been doing it right for the last couple thousand years, you're doing it wrong. Kill that. Thank you. I don't know what happened. Now I'm dead. Am I there? He stands up and he tells all these people, you're doing it wrong. For years and years and years, they thought, well, if I just keep the laws, you'll be pleased with me and you'll bless me. And Jesus comes on the scene, displaying the very nature and glory of God himself, full of deity, and says, no, that's not what I'm looking for. What I'm looking for is humility. God, you owe me nothing. I am not worthy. See, that's the proper perspective. Jesus Christ, you are Lord, and creation must submit to its creator. Just one word, Lord, I acknowledge your power and my lack of power. That's what grabs his attention. That's what grabs his attention. So I want to ask if I could get a couple of folks to come and pass out communion. We're going to take communion together as a family as we celebrate this Jesus Christ. So if I could get any two people, come up and start handing that stuff out. Hold on to the communion elements, and we're going to take it together as a family, okay? But as you're receiving these elements, I just want to say this, that the truth of God's word is what God will use to amp up spirit-filled worship, okay? So here's the thing. If you want to be part of a church that is on fire for the Lord Jesus, and it's excited and tenaciously pursuing him and packed out with people loving on Jesus and serving Jesus and working for Jesus and praying to Jesus and praising Jesus Christ, you need to be willing to submit to the truth that you heard. You need to be willing to submit to the truth that you've heard tonight in order to see it make a difference in your life and in the life of our church. The truth is in the Word of God. And in it, God tells us who He is and how we ought to respond to Him. Not too much. Go ahead, guys. Not too much. Not too little. What we need to pray is that God will help us to stand on what is written and be that church. Amen? For real. That's where we need to stay. We don't need to add anything to God's word. We don't need to take anything away from God's word for our own convenience and fleshy desire. We need to crucify that stuff, put it on the cross, and just go with what is written in God's perfect and holy word. Okay? So hold on to that stuff for a moment, and we'll come back and we'll take communion together as a family. So I'm not going to make any apologies for the fact that I'm a church guy. I've given my life willingly, sometimes stubborn, but willingly, to the church of Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you why I've done that. When I look at Jesus Christ, and we talk about him a lot, so sometimes it might lose its edge, you know? But when you look at Jesus Christ and you reflect on what you have in your hand and what it represents, like what he did, just the one thing, forget everything else. You know, we're supposed to take communion in remembrance of him. So forget everything else that he did, the stuff that's in here, the stuff that never made it into here because he lived, 30 plus years, so it's not all in there. But if you just take all the rest of it aside and just think about the cross and what he endured for us, for you, right? Thank you, Michael. You think about that, and I do, it drives me back to the church. Not necessarily just the building, but to the work of the ministry, right? I mean, I don't know about you, but I think that this commands more. Wherever you're at, whatever your level of service and commitment is to the Lord, I think that this, it commands, it demands more. And when I share with you tonight about the church, about coming to church, I mean what I say when a church wants to be a thriving community of faith that really impacts a city of, people are in Leesburg, 20, 30,000 people. You want to impact that city, you got to be rocking, man. You got to be rocking. People need to walk in here and experience the living God when they're here. It needs to be something of high impact. And so when you think about this, that's what I want to do tonight. I want to think, when we take communion, to do it in remembrance of him. I want to think about the cross and the pain and the suffering that he endured. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. What was the joy set before him? You, his bride, his church, right here. This is what he did it for. It's really important, man. It's really important. So before you take the communion, think about what you said. I know I baited you, Michael's right, I did. But think about what you said. Think about what God's word says. Jesus Christ went to church every day. He taught there. His word says, don't neglect meeting together. The church of Jesus Christ is the single provision to save the world. Do you understand your role? It's really important. So pray with me. Father, I'm leading these people in this prayer right now, but really, I might as well be alone in the room at this moment, because I need help with what Paul finally figured out. That compared to the intimacy with you, compared to having you in my life, everything else is worthless. And so Lord, I pray that the things that are in our lives that would stand in opposition to the relationship that you went to the cross to create in me, that those things right now would die, be done. Let my heart's allegiance be shifted from those things to you. And I ask that you would do the same in all of us right now. Some of us will say yes to this. Some of us will put up a stubborn, hard heart and not want this. But we're shooting for the real thing here, Lord. We're shooting for the real thing. We want people who really follow you. They're not following social mandates. They're following the Word of God. That's what we're shooting for. That's what you want for this church. So, Lord, if there's anyone here that has things in their life that are in opposition to the lordship of Jesus Christ in their life, I would ask in your name that you'd get rid of those things. Help them to set them aside and put you first. In our hand, Lord, you gave us a gift. It's an opportunity to remember back to what you have done for us. The perfect Son of God, who knew no sin, yet became sin so that we, loved ones, could become the righteousness of God. And that was done by going to the cross and giving your body willingly so that we didn't have to. And this bread represents your body. And we take it in remembrance of this. Lord, I feel like just saying this. You meant business. You meant business. You meant business on the cross. This was no game. This was the real deal. You're going to build your church. And you're going to use us to do it. We are spiritual stones being built into the temple of God, us right here. And this was done on the cross, where your body was broken and your blood poured out as your signature on this deal right here. You committed to your bride right here with your blood. As we take this, Lord, help our level of commitment to you. Take this cup in remembrance of him. Father, I thank you for this group of people right here. This message won't get preached at most churches, but I believe with all my heart that these people that you have brought here want you, desire you, crave you, and as the deer pants for streams of water, oh, my soul longs for you, Lord. And I believe that these people say that. I believe these hearts are there. And so I thank you for these people who want the truth, who want to follow you as you have laid out in Scripture. So I thank you, Lord, for these people right here tonight and the opportunity to share your word. Lord, let it be used to transform our lives. Let us be different. Let us be Christ-like. Christians follow Christ. Help us to do so. In Jesus' name, amen.